I'm very big on the tithing. I've been blessed by it because I've been down. And I'll talk about that quite a bit because I've been down where most people don't want to be. So, and I've come out of that due to tithing and the Lord. But tithing's got my finances and all that, but just being here and giving my life to the Lord has cured my other side as well. So I want to talk, the reason I like it so much is I've been blessed beyond belief in this. And even though the storms have come through the entire time, I've always risen out of the storm. So, and the reason I'm so passionate is because I have noticed through the tithing, I've noticed all my finances change, my health change, my life change, every bit of it has changed. And I can take it back to the beginning of the tithing. And it really starts with our heart. If you don't have the heart to give, it's not going to work. You all know that. You know, the Lord wants our heart without a doubt. And he knows how to get it. And in Matthew 6:21, it'll even show you, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. I was in Iraq for a while, and I was doing trips over there, and I was over there due to tithing, and we'll talk about that in a minute. I had to go chase the money because the money was not coming to me. But while I was over there, I got there I am making the money, and how am I going to spend this money? But it'll show you where your heart is. I started on penny stocks. Somebody's like, hey, you got to try this penny stocks. And I was like, well, all right, I got real curious about it. We're talking. And all of a sudden, I found myself, here's $500. I'm playing the penny stocks and this and that. And all of a sudden, I'm learning about biodiesel coming out of LG and this and that. And all of a sudden, there's my heart into the penny stocks. I'm chasing these stocks. Here it is. I'm waking up in the morning. First thing I do, I'm on the computer. What's this doing? What's that doing? Because I had my heart. So the Lord knows right from there, if you're doing your tithing and your 10% and it's going in the church, guess where your heart's going to be? It's going to be right there. So He knows if we are tithing. He knows exactly where we're going to be, and He's going to bless us with it. Now, there's parts of that to go with it. You know, there's one thing between tithing your 10% because we are told to, or being that cheerful giver. You know, that's a big difference. If you're sitting there and you're turning in, I made $1,000 and I turn in my $100, but I'm just doing it because here it is, I got to do it. Well, you're not going to get the results. He wants the person that sits there and says, I am absolutely in this because this is your money anyways, Lord. That 10% was never my money. And I'm giving it back to you because it's not my money, because I know what you're going to do with it. And I know that souls will be saved and what will come out of it and the blessings that are here. You know, the people think, oh, the pastors will preach up here, oh, the money goes to this, and it's paying a salary, and it's paying this, and it's paying that. Well, parts of that is correct, but we forget all the other stuff that comes with it. The souls that sit out here, the souls that you reach out here, you've got new people stepping in the church telling you what just happened to them. And that's because this light bill's being paid, and that's because we're up here talking about it. When I go back to before I was tithing, Shelly and I had just got married. As you know, she's raised in the Church of God. And back then, you know, I was with Brother Hugo and them, and he'd come over the house. We bought a lake house, and we left a paid-off house. Not really sure why we did that, but we did it. Really, we outgrew it, but we could have added on. But we made this decision to move to the lake. It was a dream to live to the lake. She was making good money. I was in aviation. It was before the economy fell apart. Aviation was going well. And, of course, we were never tithing. And I knew that she knew that. But we weren't going to church either. And all of a sudden, as you think everything is good, I've got this lake house. I've got this. We had a ski boat that we were out wakeboarding with the kids all the time. His family was coming over. You think the world's great because here you are. Well, as time chips away, all of a sudden, economy starts to fall. The aviation was starting to fall. I move into a different industry. At that time, I was buying cars and that industry, you know, doing that. Totally come out of the thing. And at one point, I even moved to the cars. Went back to aviation. And it was going good again, so I thought. With the economy going bad, well, people weren't paying for the planes. People quit flying planes. They had to do this. And all of a sudden, I'm not getting paychecks. I'm delayed a week. I'm delayed 2 weeks. I'm pushing 3 weeks. I've got boat payments. I've got house payments, insurances, just standard operational money that you need to survive. And like I said, I didn't know anything about tithing. And I know Shelly did, but I know at that point, like I said, we weren't talking about it. And I probably need to apologize to her because we didn't go through it. As I grew up in Catholic, I knew you gave the money. It wasn't explained to me. I don't want to say it wasn't explained to the church. You know, I didn't pay attention anyways when I was there. It just didn't fit in. But so from there, when it started to fall apart, that's when I realized, hey, I've got to find another job because I can't even get paid to this one. So off to Iraq I go, chasing the money, because I needed that just to survive, as you would think. But no money's going to the Lord. I had no idea all this money I was making. You know, I think every 4 months it was like $60,000, $65,000 to work over there. But I had no idea all that money was being cursed because I didn't give my part to the Lord. And as Shelly has preached to me and I've read and I've learned, I understand exactly what that curse is now. But it took a long road to get there. We lost that house. We put $100,000 of our own money into the house because we bought it, we had to restore it, we built it up, and we used our own cash on that part. We took the loan and used our own hard cash to do that part of it and get it where we needed to live in it. So when everything fell apart, because I didn't want to travel no more, my third trip was going to Afghanistan. And at that time, we were going to Kandahar. And that was right when they were fighting inside the Kandahar city. And they had rockets coming every which way. And that's when Shelly told me, she said, there's no money worth your life. So that's when I stopped going. At that time, we said, whatever happens, happens. Well, it did. We technically lost the house. We had to do a short sale. So I don't know if it was $500,000. I think we sold it for $350,000. And the bank helped us with that. But we didn't get any of our money. We're out $100,000. It's gone. We've got no credit. And we ended up getting another house on an owner finance program. We didn't like that house, but it was what we had to have. We knew that this was where at this point, we're glad to have this house. So it was hard to accept that house because we know how we got there. But from there, this is also where everything started to change. Because Shelly and I never spoke about this, but I know that this is where things change, because she knew where it went wrong, where I did not. That's where she had a great, great upbringing, great knowledge, and great how everything goes. She joined Covenant Ministry, and that's when she started going. I'd say she went there a year or so without me, I think, I give or take. But she told me, she said, "Keith, we've got to tithe." And she explained it. I said, "Okay, I understand." You know, I said, she's my accountant anyways. I couldn't have told her no anyways. It would have came regardless. But she started tithing. Now, did it fix overnight? Most definitely not. You know, it's a work in progress. But everything started to come out of it. Everything started to come through a little bit here, a little bit there. We start getting our bills a little bit in order. But at that time, it still wasn't coming in all in order, because I wasn't here. I wasn't saved. So we still had, we had some of the pieces, but not all the pieces. And then when you guys came here, that's, you know, basically the more of that story. That's where, when I was living horrible. That's all there is to it. It's embarrassing to me. It's embarrassing to her. And I deeply, every day we think about that. And luckily the Lord is a forgiving Lord. And he absolutely washes it away. But from there, that's when I came here, and that's when you start seeing the changes. And we sold that house recently, and David knows all about it, but I had Brother Jeff with me every step of the way. Couldn't do a thing without him. He knew, and I knew, because we talked about it every time. We had to do this to finish the house, this to finish the house, this to get it done so we could get it on the market and get rid of it, because we had moved on to the next level. And every step of the way, I would tell, you know, I'm like, "Jeff, we've got to cut this. We've got to do this. I don't know how, but we've got to get there without the money." But every time we got there, and because Jeff knows, we got it done every time. Somehow we had money for the materials. Somehow I had money to pay him and to continue on with the project. And I know how the money got there. You know, it's just coming from the, just things would show up. You know, we had one time just like, "How in the world can we get this?" And we get a letter from our mortgage company that said, "Hey, you didn't cash a check that we sent you. Did you receive the check?" We're like, "What in the world?" And you know, you get all that junk mail, you throw it away. Well, there we were, throwing it all away. We threw over $1,000-some escrow check out that we didn't know was there. I promise you, we threw it away because we didn't need it then. You might have thought you needed it, but right now we're in this jam, and all of a sudden you call them up, "We'll send you another one." And all of a sudden, right there it is to get on to the next project. So it just, the reason I'm going down this path is the cheerful side. We have got to stay on the cheerful side. That's going to be more of the blessing that you get. The Lord wants our cheerful giver, without a doubt. If we go to Deuteronomy 15:10, I have a bunch of more testimony and stories to go, but we've got to get some other stuff in here with it that I have learned over the middle of this and worked on. It says, "You shall surely give to him, and your heart should not be grieved when you give to him. Because for this, the Lord your God will bless you in all your works and all to which you put your hand. That goes with our, the Lord wants us to be that cheerful giver. And he will continue to bless and move on as we continue to be that cheerful giver. Because the last thing is, we don't need a selfishness. Selfishness is in us from the beginning. We all know that. I mean, it's pure and simple. When you got your kids, even older kids, what's the hardest part? They always want what the other one's got. It's born into us. We cannot help it. You know, you cannot help the selfishness. We've got to come away from that. You know, and when you have, you've got two parts of it with an uncheerful giver. You've got your selfishness, and then you got your grief. Your selfishness is when you didn't want to give back the money that was not yours. Is that correct? I mean, it's not your money, but yet you don't want to, it's in your hand, you don't want to give it back. But then you got the grief side of it. And I'm sure every one of us can say that. You've given it, and all of a sudden you're like, there it goes. You put it in the basket. And all of a sudden, the next day it comes, and boom, your check engine light comes on in the car. Well, jeepers. That's going to cost me $80 for a diagnostic. Guess how much I put in the basket? $80. If I didn't do that, then here I would be. That's the sides of it that we've got to get rid of, because when those storms that still come, there's the way out. And it's not through the grief. He knows our heart. You know, just like it's supposed to be our first tenth, you know. And that's, once again, Shelly does our bills. So instantly, she's the first one. She takes her paychecks. She writes a check out and slides it to the side. When we come on Sunday, here it comes. Now, let's say we got paid that day, and you know, I go to work, or anybody goes to work. Well, I go, oh, my gas tank's low. I got to pull over and get gas. Well, Shelly hadn't made it home to do the checks yet. Does that mean that you didn't do that? No, the Lord knows our heart. He knows when you did your bills, you filled it out, and that's what you did, because that's what the first thing you looked at. He's not thinking you stopped at the gas. You didn't purposely not do. You didn't take your bills. Say I had $2,000 here. Okay, I'm going to car insurance, mortgage, electric bill, food bill. Well, okay, I got enough for the Lord. That's what he's talking about. That's not first. The first is when that first check went to it. So, and it goes right with there. And also in Deuteronomy 15:14, you shall supply him liberally from your flock, from your threshing floor, from your wine press, from what the Lord has blessed you with, you shall give to him. And I'm going to give another example of the trust and the cheerful giver. One of the nicest people in the world stopped me the other day. We're out in the parking lot talking. And her mother, without a doubt, I wish I'd seen her. I wish I'd met her. But she talked about on the tithing and what it has done for them. She said she was a little girl. They didn't have any money, no money whatsoever. And she said that her mother had opened up all the cabinet drawers. There was no food in there, none. She said, Mama, why are you opening up those cabinets? And basically some of the story was, I'm a tither and I know that my Lord will fill those cabinets. And I asked her, I said, so what's the end of the story? She said our cabinets were full with food. None that they paid for, somebody else had brought in through the Lord and filled those drawers. You can't make that stuff up. There is no way you can make that up. And you have your two tithers. You have the blessed tither and the one that can't afford. And that's kind of another thing that led me on this, gave me confirmation. I got a phone call, I got a text Tuesday. He said, hey, I've given up. I've trusted everything in the Lord, but I'm not getting back what I need. He said, I just don't think I can handle it no more. So I was on my way to Clinton for training, and I texted him. I said, I'll call you in a minute. So on my way, I call him up. I said, hey, just tell me what's going on. So he gives me the whole story. He says, this job didn't work out. I moved to this job. This job didn't work out. So here I am. I'm over here. Don't really want to be here. I feel like I should be making more money. I'm not. And I've had to take a loan out of my truck, a title loan, because I don't have money to even eat. And he went on to a few more items that he didn't have. I said, okay. I said, now, do you care if I speak openly with you? He said, most definitely. And, of course, he knows this man very well. I said, I'm fixing to go David Thompson on you. I said, here's my question. Have you been tithing? No, I haven't. I said, okay. I said, well, about how long ago did all this come about? He said, 5-6 months ago. I said, okay. I said, now we both know that's when you left the church. And that also means that's when your tithing and everything quit. I said, leaving a church is one thing. You know, I said, if you didn't agree with what it was, that's why we got a church on every corner. It's not about coming to our church. It's about going to church. So on that part of it, we got into the tithing. I said, and that's when your finances fell apart, didn't it? Yes. And I said, all of a sudden you got cut off here, you got cut off there, you're having trouble making rent, you can't pay this bill, you're having to borrow from here to pay here. I said, do you see the trend of where it started and when you quit and when your trust quit? I said, that's when it fell apart. So that's the part on the side of the cheerful giver, and of course the ones that can't afford to pay tithes. And that's where, even in the very beginning, I go back to when we had that house, I'm not so sure that I would have tithed then, because I thought I had everything anyways. It wasn't until everything fell apart that I realized the importance of what really comes. And to see where we dug out of to where we are now. The house we had, the one that we just bought, we're already getting our money back on it. You know, when we had it appraised, the guy says, this is $75,000 under appraisal. I says, praise God. So I've already got $75,000 back in my money. But then we put a small investment in the house once again through Jeff. We pinched here and there. I guarantee you I can sell it now for every bit of that $100,000 and more that we lost before. So it is the test of our faith. And I love another example, because we get, let's go to the Robin God, and pastors already read this. We're going to do Malachi 3:8-12, okay? And we all know this, and you all have heard it 1,000 times, but guess what? We're doing 1,001 today. So, okay, I'm going to go ahead and read this for us here. Will a man rob God yet you have robbed me. But you say, in what way have we robbed you? In tithes and offering. You are cursed with a curse, and you have robbed me. Even this whole nation brings all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house, and try me now in this, says the Lord of hosts. If I will not open the windows of heaven and pour out such a blessing that there will not be room enough to receive it. We would think right there would be enough to say, I've got to do this. But now that I've come where I'm at, and I know I can speak from the experiences, I can't imagine robbing the Lord at this point. I mean, you're talking the one that's every star he knows. As I lose my hair, he knows which one fell out and which one he put back. And that's the person that we're going to shortchange? That just don't even make sense to me at this point. It just blows me away. And the thing is, nobody in here, I know this for a fact, and I was talking to a pastor about this one time, and he finished the statement that made it exactly correct. If I put back there $500 and I left it in the seat, and it was completely unattended, and I let people come in and out of here, this entire church members, without a shadow of a doubt in my mind, that money's going to sit there. And it will not move until Sister Sheila cleans the chair, picks it up, and brings it to pastor's desk and calls him and says, I found $500 that was left here on the church. That's the only way I know for a fact that's going to move. So if we won't steal our own brother's money, why would we steal the Lord's and have our bank account cursed? That's not... And the reason I'm preaching like this is because I want you, if you are not a tither, and I hope everybody in here is, but if you are not, I want you to experience the blessing that I've been able to have. And it's over the top. And it's a fair thing. You know, I used to listen to Neil Bortz down in Atlanta. He was a wonderful talk show host. I really liked him. He was one of the, I don't know if he's one of the creators, but he was a huge promoter of fair tax. If anybody's familiar with that, that's when they want to get away. All taxes, federal tax, state tax. Here it is. Everything goes to a certain percent. This is what you pay. Whether you have a job, you don't have a job, whether you're legal, illegal, it hits us all the same. That percentage is right there. So when you go in the store, I pay the same thing you do. I buy this, I pay the same thing you do. And that's what the Lord, he said, the 10%, he just put a number. It don't matter if you make $100,000 a year or you make $20 a year, your 10% is the same. It hits everybody exactly the same. And I know, let me ask a question, because I already know my answer. If you take your paycheck and you look at it and you, would you rather have 100% of your money and have it cursed? Or would you rather have 90% of it and have it completely blessed by the Lord? Amen. You tell me what you would choose, and you tell me which way you think you're going to come out ahead. Because I already know which way I've come out ahead. There's just no way around that. But you know, there's more to it. This is truly the Lord. I think it's a much more sensitive subject than we even think about with the Lord, because we look at it as money, and we think, well, he's got to, you know, he's the creator of this. He doesn't need a dollar of our money. He's created an entire world, including us. He didn't use a dollar. He didn't use $1 to create anything. He don't need our money. That's just the faithfulness that he asked from us. Amen. This is and why I think it's so special, so more special than we even get, that we even think about, is he gave his firstborn. Gave his firstborn, brought him down, and knew what was going to happen for us. Beaten, spit on, crown put on him, nailed to a cross. When you watch the movie and you see him going through that stake, through your ankles, you can't even imagine it. He gave up his firstborn for that. And we look at it as why we can't give our 10%. So if you don't think it's a little more close to him than we think it is, you're wrong. You are absolutely wrong on that. So there's so much more than we will even look at. And you know, he wants the first 10%. He's not going to accept second. That is absolutely not. He will not take that second handout. That will mean absolutely nothing to him. Because once again, he put his firstborn down for us so that we, and only asked us of 10% of our money. Could you imagine and I've been there. I had to take, my son was going for a 1-year-old well baby checkup, and they had to draw blood. So I've got this, he wasn't one yet, he's close to 11 months. The boy only knows me and his mother. He's just so perfect, so innocent, And he had to sit in my lap, and I had to hold his arm out so they could draw blood. And I sat there and could bawl as they're putting this needle in his arm, and he's crying, and I can't do a thing about it. And then they can't find the vein. He said, hey, we're going to have to try the other arm. I said, no, you're not. I said, we can do the other arm, but you're not doing it. Because that's how protective we are of that. And so how hard was it for me to know this is okay? I've only got a pinprick. And the Lord has his first and only son being nailed to a cross for us as he watches it. And he takes it for us. It's that important of our 10%. And it's that important for us to give that so that we can receive. He wants to bless us if we would just allow it. So it's, and like I said, I wanted to be here. And I wanted to go over this so that you guys maybe could see, and maybe I could help you get every bit of that from all of the blessings. Because, you know, just like the firstborn, Leviticus 27:30, and all the tithe of the land, whether of the seed of the land or of the fruit of the tree, is the Lord's. It is holy to the Lord. And that's where I was getting at with his firstborn and what he did for us and what we have to do. So I just wanted to bring that to you. I've cut out half the stuff I was even going to talk about because it got a little passionate for me. But I can give you a couple more stories if you got another minute, you know, just the blessings that I saw. Like I said, when I thought I had the money, it was coming in, and it wasn't. And several of you have heard this story, but to me, it just blows my mind, because every time I probably told it 1,000 times, and I can't not tell it. But it's so simple, but it's not. 3 years ago or so, 3-4 years ago, we once again, it was during the times that Shelly had been out of work, and we were coming back, and I had gotten into the church, and everything was starting to come around. And it come Christmas, Hannah was getting married, and she's in college, and we still got two other boys, and we were catching up on everything where she had been out of work. and everything was falling in place. And then it don't take a whole lot to rock that boat. And a washer machine went out. Okay. So I had one of our friends come over, Jim, come over and looks at it. It was a front load. He said, "Keith, that's $1,800 to fix it." He said, "The whole barrel went out. It's out of whack. It's this, it's that," which I don't even know how that would even happen. I've never heard of a washer machine, and you could see it. You spin it, and it'd wobble. And so I said, "He really need to get a new one." I said, "Okay." So I had a small Sears warranty through a different program. You could buy it after. It does appliances. And it would give me a $500 credit towards a new machine if they could not, if it cost too much to fix it. So we had that, and a new store had opened up in Knoxville. It's like a Sears warehouse type thing. You get overflow, scratch dents. And but during all of this, it was right before Christmas, and like I said, things were crazy short. And Shelly writes a tithe check Saturday night before church. She says, "Keith, this is all we got. If I turn this in, the kids don't have Christmas." I said, "We've got no choice." So she goes, "I agree." So we turn it in. And I had already prepared the kids. I talked to them. I said, look, guys. I said, "You know the whole situation. We're sorry, but we know later on we'll be able to come back and we'll have Christmas. Without a doubt, it may not be on that day, but we will have Christmas." So, surprisingly, because, you know, I knew Hannah would be okay. Our two boys are a little different. And surprisingly, they were like, "That's no problem. We know." And I was like, "Praise God." So, that week, coming up to Christmas, my family knew nothing about, I do not talk financials with my family, period. And all of a sudden, my grandmother and I think my dad, I don't even remember, but we had two checks come in before Christmas. We had no idea were coming. No idea whatsoever. And I'll be darned, those kids didn't have an excellent Christmas that they didn't even think were having. So we're holding off on the washer for obvious reasons. Well, now we can't wait no more, and New Year's comes around. So we go up to the Sears, and we said, "Well, let's look and see," because I knew we weren't going to spend the whole, I really thought we'd be around that $500 thing. And we get up there, and oh, your eyes light up. And I saw Shelly's light up. Here's this nice washer. It's a front load, and it's probably twice the size of the one we got. And it's got some damage on the side that would affect nothing because we can't even see it because that's where it'd be against our wall. And it was like right at $1,499. So $1,500 for this washer. And they marked it down 50%. So here we are with 50% off of it. And we're down to 700 and some change and everything. And I said, "Well, we got $500 credit." I said, "We'll have to come up with, you know, $200-$300 plus the tax." And even Shelly's like, "Darn it." Because that $200-$300 might as well have been $30,000 at that moment. And I'm sure some of you have felt that before, you know. So we said, "You know what, we can move this around or figure this out. We'll make it work." And that day, the warranty office through the holidays, it was not open. And it was a different guy working. I said, "Hey, don't sell this. We'll be back tomorrow." He said, "No problem." So we go back the next day, and I'm looking at it, and I said, "I'm here to purchase the washer." And the manager's there, and I said, I've got a number here. This is my warranty number, the credit for $500. And he says, "Okay, now it's a new store." So he's sitting there, and he makes phone calls because he doesn't know how to apply the credit plus the difference that we have to pay. He's on the phone. He says, "Okay, I think I got it." Click, he hangs up. And I'm standing there, and the line's building around me, and Shelly comes over, and I says, "Well, we're just having trouble figuring out how to split the differences." She says, "Okay," and she leaves. And the guy's working and working and working, and he says, you know what? He said, I can't figure it out. He said, you don't owe me a penny. And I'm like, holy cow. So Shelly comes over and the line's around me. I don't want the people to know because they don't know what's going on. They're just thinking, you know. So she comes over and she's like, hey, did you guys get it figured out? I'm like, shh, you know. She's like, oh, okay. So, but we're walking out the store and she says, well, what happened? And I said, well, how faithful is your God? And she says, very. I says, we don't owe a dollar. It was like just the tears come out. But who you tell me, and this comes with how you could not be that cheerful giver. You tell me, I just want to know anywhere you could go today, and you walk in and you say, I need this $1,499 washer, but I don't want to pay for it. And I'm going to take it with me. It isn't going to happen. It will not happen, but it does to the cheerful giver. And I'll tell you that because that is me. And that is my wife. I thank her because she taught me two things. She taught me millions of things. But the first two things was the tithing, and then the next was there's power in the name of Jesus. Those are the two things that she taught me. And I really need to get in that last part because my friend, he's an officer with me. I told him last night that I was preaching. We went to the academy together, everything. He goes over to Oral Baptist, really good guy. And I said, hey, Alan, I said, I'm preaching tomorrow. He goes, what? He got mad because I didn't tell him because he plays in the music. He would have came over. And I said, no. I said, it's all right. And he sent me a text this morning. He said, hey, Keith. He said, it's pretty important to mention Jesus when you're preaching today. But, you know, I can go story after story, and I don't want to stand up because there's just, I mean, I've had recent ones, you know, Jeff's been through me with all this house stuff, but I was just telling Pastor the other day, you know, when we sold our house, we put the $12,000 we allocated to escrow so we could do the roof after, and It's a big roof. They said it's roughly 60 square was the roof, and it's in the material. So I said, I'll go buy the materials and you do the labor. And this is a roofing company, and they said, so I go over there and I get the materials. It was $4,900. He said, the labor's going to be about $4,800. So I knew I'll still have $2,000 of the escrow come back to me. And I thought, well, oh my, that's tight, you know, but thank goodness we had the money in there. And so from there, he gets done. He says, Keith, he says, man, I way overshot. He said, it was only 40 some square and you can take them back, which is still a surprise because most roofers have already packed that up and it's gone. Your material's gone because that's how much they put on there. It's how much you quoted. That's how much they gave you. And they're going to do that. Now, that's not everybody, and we know this. And thankful for this, this was the one I had. So he marks his labor from $4,800 to $3,200. And then I take all the materials back, and I got $1,500 back just in material. So I got another $3,000 just off of this that I wasn't expecting. And that's why I asked Pastor. I get so torn, so excited about it to talk about it and go on about it. And I know I skipped so much scripture that I was going to go through. But I know you all will read it, and it's 1,000%. Every word that's in there is a 10%, 10, 10, 10, tie, this and that. But I want you to hear it from me because that's what I've experienced. And I know for a fact, and it's so in my heart, that if you guys, if you're not tithing now and you take this opportunity, you will be blessed forever, I promise you.